Hello, my nieces and nephews and my fellow aunties and uncles. How are you guys doing? I am your girl, Auntie Tiffany. And we have finally come to an end. This is the end of the road when it comes to the Harry and Meghan documentary. And as I said prior, there have been crying, there has been anger, there has been some happiness. Every emotion you can think of to feel, you felt in this documentary. And I'm glad that we were able to see it, because it was something that needed to be seen. And I'm glad that the truth is out and that Meghan and Harry both were able to tell their stories and tell their truth from their perspective and just the truth in general. And you guys will hear the rest of my assessment of the show in the podcast. I did do it the same way I did the prior episode, where I went piece by piece, and when I wanted to talk about something specific, I would talk about it and then pause the show and continue and pause and continue. So you're going to hear changes again, in my opinion, as the show progresses down to the end. So hope you guys enjoy, and I'll see you guys in there. As time progressed, you start to see what was really happening. They ain't gonna say it, but I'll say it. William and Charles were doing everything in their power to suppress whatever stories were in the media about them. And they let these articles run, no matter if they put it out there or not. They let these articles run that would demonize Meghan and Harry at some points and destroy both of them. They would destroy both of those people to save their own asses. And that's exactly what happened. They essentially created the mob. They emboldened the mob and they gave them the tools to tear this woman down and try to destroy Meghan and Harry. They knew, with her being such a polarizing figure for the monarchy, because she's not timid and quiet like the other girls are, they knew that she was going to be an easy target, and they used that to take her out. And they had no issues with doing it. They did it with no malice, with all the malice, I guess you could say, in their heart. Because the way that you knew that this was true was there was a story that came out about William bullying Harry. And immediately that story was squashed with a statement, a joint statement that didn't come from Harry himself. Harry went and had the meeting with his grandmother, his father, and his brother. He said there was shouting from William's end, shouting from Charles's end. They were attacking him verbally in the meeting and basically gave him an ultimatum of, you're either all in or you're all out. Harry was like, I'm proposing still being able to do things for the Commonwealth and dedicate ourselves to the Queen, but we don't want, and we'll support ourselves financially and do our own thing, but we will still do the charity work and run the charities for free. We won't ask for any money to do these things. They said, no, you're either all in with the monarchy the way that it is, or you're all out. He said they left that meeting with no definitive answer as to what they were going to do. And he sees this joint statement telling everybody, oh, well, William and Harry think these are false narratives and that this isn't right. And, you know, it's potentially harmful for you to print these things. But they didn't have a problem with letting Meghan be demonized. And when he called Meghan and told Meghan the meeting and what happened with the press, she was in tears. She was just like, I can't believe this. They protected William, but they let Harry and Meghan, they was fed to the wolves. And I see what's going on here. It's a lot of manipulation. I do think that in the beginning, I felt that with what we were being told by how they described the relationship, that they did like Meghan. I think that they did in the beginning, but they saw very early on that she was going to be an easy target and they could alleviate some pressures off of themselves and put it onto them. And it'll just be like, well, this is just what you have to deal with. Everybody has to deal with this. And Harry's like, nah, man, like this is different. This is different. This is different. You know, like this is more of an onslaught than it ever has been. This is ugly. It keeps getting uglier. This is different. So I think that William and Charles both, I think Charles's camp leaked the emails of Harry's. I think that William's camp helped to leak that shit too, because that scandal would be in the news for months, you know, and they wouldn't have to worry about a story that's gonna come out about them. That shit would be squashed before it could even get out, because they're just gonna keep doubling down on Harry and Meghan. And it's sad because that's your nephew, that's your brother. You know, y'all promised each other y'all would never do this, and here you are. It's sad. It's really sad. Now come to the part where they are talking about the online hate. Harry was talking to a journalist about the online bullying and the hate. And they really broke it down with Bot Sentinel about how a handful of coordinated accounts was responsible for all of the hate and ugliness that Harry and Meghan were experiencing. So much so that her own sister was a part of the hate campaign. She claims that her account was hacked. I don't believe her. I don't believe her account was hacked. I believe she fully was indoctrinated into this hate campaign because she's jealous. She's a jealous, evil little bitch. And I just don't believe that she was hacked. I believe she was a part of it and kept creating new accounts so that she can continue to do this ignorant shit. And it's cruel. It's disrespectful. It's so out of line. She says she got up one morning and they were doing a security detail, and she went through the booklet that they have to go through every morning, and she looked through it, and there was online monitoring, and it was like, if you see a tweet like this, you need to report it. And the tweet says, Meghan Markle just needs to die. Somebody needs to kill her. Maybe I'll do it. I'm just like, what? Are you fucking serious right now? Like, why would you just say that? Like, why would you do that to a person? It just doesn't make any sense to me. It's so damn sad. And it's like you didn't even try to be just fucking normal. Like, y'all are online literally tweeting shit out like this. And then when they actually do pass away, you want to tweet your condolences and shit. Like, you don't have a problem with making this person feel like they're unsafe. She has two kids that she's trying to take care of, and you're on the internet talking about you want her to die and that you're possibly contemplating doing it. That makes a lot of fucking sense. Jesus, Mary and Joseph. I feel so bad for this lady, her whole family. I feel bad for them because she just didn't deserve this. So I'm on episode 5, and essentially this detailed how Meghan Markle's personal letter ended up being excuse me, printed in the Daily Mail. And that letter was intercepted, falsely signed for. They were upset because her father was taking interviews, doing interviews, being paid for interviews, and he was lying. You know, he wasn't speaking to Meghan, hadn't spoken to her in over a year. And he was taking interviews, likening the institution of the royal family to the Scientology cult, really going in on everybody within the institution, including the Queen and Harry's father. It got so bad that when they intercepted that letter, because the recommendation to write the letter came from the Queen herself, including Prince Charles. They both recommended that she write a letter. It ended up getting intercepted after she sent it to her business manager, who then in turn delivered it to her father, but the person who signed for it was not her father. So obviously her father had somebody else there, probably her oldest daughter, who was intercepting her mail or whatever. And she got this letter and they ended up printing it. They sold the letter more than likely. Or the Daily Mail had scouts and went and stole the letter from the man's mailbox, which in itself is a damn crime because you're not supposed to open other people's mail. Anyways, so she said when she got the signature confirmation back, it was signed Thomas, and that's not her dad's signature. That's not how he signs things. So she knew that the letter had been intercepted, and then not even a day or so later, the full letter was printed in the media, but parts of it was redacted. Now, the institution did not want to pursue legal action due to the fact that because they pay the monarchy to have access to them, they felt like suing them would be a slap in the face. So they went and hunted for, they went and talked to the institution lawyer. They refused. So they went and got outside counsel to sue the Daily Mail for posting Meghan Markle's letter. They only posted parts of it to paint her like she was just scolding her father for making her look bad or whatever. But in fact, she just was hurt that her father was doing this to her. And she wanted to tell him that. And he, you know, didn't listen, wanted to listen, didn't care. I mean, her dad need help in more ways than one. But this suing of the media is what caused this massive spark of tension and ridiculousness. And it became Harry and Meghan versus the institution. And what they did was they was doing everything in their power to ice them out. So they would lie and tell them things that everything was okay. And like, yes, you could do this. Yes, you could do that. And then as soon as they wouldn't, you know, they would do it that the institution's way, they would find a way to plant a bad story in the media just because they could. This was happening over and over again to the point where they was like, okay, we need to come up with a plan. In 2018, I think it was 2020 actually, they had went up to a palace. They went and rented this home. It was on an island. There were no paparazzi there. And they look up, paparazzi is in the water coming up to their home to take pictures. Just all kinds of crazy shit. And Harry is just like, okay, we need to put this plan in motion. What are we going to do? Excuse me. I'm sorry, y'all. I'm just a little tired, but I'm going to get through it. Put this plan in motion. So what are we going to do? Basically, they was just like, okay, well, we could go to New Zealand. And then they decided, no, New Zealand's not it. And they were like, let's go to South Africa. You know, Harry's partial to South Africa. That's like his second home.
Meghan loves doing the charitable work in South Africa. They wanted to go set up shop in South Africa and do their charity work completely separate from the Queen. They didn't want to have to worry about, you know, money. They was going to fund it all themselves. They didn't need none of that. That was the plan. They put it in writing, gave it to the comms, and all of a sudden, boom, story hits the news. The Duke and Duchess of Sussex are going to South Africa. He was like, great. Now, he was like, okay, Canada, we can go to Canada. Commonwealth is in Canada. Definitely can help out with that stuff. We go to Canada, still continue all of the Queen's work in Canada, and that's it. They put that story in. The father, Harry's father, said, did you put it in writing? Harry said, I'd rather not. Last time we did, the story got leaked. Excuse me, y'all. Harry's father says, I can't do anything if you don't put it in writing. So Harry puts it in writing. 5 days later, the story is leaked. They're going to Canada. Meghan's spoiled and selfish. Just all types of shit is being put out there. It's very, very, very sad. He then decided he was going to go back and talk to his grandma. Have a conversation with her. Him, Meghan, and his grandma was just going to have lunch and talk and really clear some things up and figure out what they was going to do next, since this obviously the plans they had in motion for the last year have now busted. He called his grandma. His grandma said, sure, honey, we can have a conversation. I don't have anything to do this week. Called back to confirm. And they told her no. They told him, you can't talk to your grandmother. She is busy the whole week. She has something she has to do. Harry said, that's not what I had been told, but okay. So they went on ahead and called the grandmother back. The grandmother says, yeah, I wasn't aware that I was busy this week, but they told me that I am. I'm busy all week. Essentially, Meghan figured it out. She said, they blocking you from seeing your grandmother. They blocking you. They coming in now and trying to come in between you and your family. This is so wrong on so many levels. And I'm just like, how can you with good conscience do that? And then go home to your families and sit at the table and eat dinner with your wife and your kids, knowing what you've done to this man and his grandmother. Like, that is the only living adult outside of his father that is still alive and well. And this is what you do. Besides his brother, William. I'm just floored right now. So freaking upset.
So the decision was made clear that Harry and Meghan would abdicate their role as the Duke and Duchess of Sussex, and that they would no longer represent the Queen or the monarchy in any way, shape, or form. They would move back to Canada, raise their children and that in Canada, and live their lives there and do their charity work on their own. They would pay their own bills. They would do everything on their own. They would receive no support from the institution at all. Meghan and Harry did a final tour with the institution. They were there for their final day. Harry said it felt cold. It looked cold, therefore it was cold. And he just said after that, there was no conversation between him, his father, or his brother, or even the Queen. Essentially, they just went back to the palace, changed it to regular clothes, and here Meghan went up, caught a flight, and got back to Archie as quickly as possible. She said after the trip was over and they finally touched down in Canada, she was talking to one of the security that was with Harry for just about majority of his adult life. And she said she just collapsed in his arms and she just cried that she tried. And that really broke my heart because I felt like she tried as hard as she could, almost to the point where she damn near killed herself. So, you know, there was that. Before that, they were on the plane. A man walked and stood next to her. He knelt down beside her, took his hat off and said that, you know, we appreciate the what you did for our country. And she just made it very clear. She was like, somebody recognized my sacrifice. And it was refreshing because she said it wasn't a sacrifice that I made for my own country. It was for a different country. It was for my husband's country. It was for them. And she thought that the people would hate her, that they never wanted to see her, but it was quite the opposite. The people were never the problem. The problem were only a few ignorant few and the monarchy. The monarchy was not prepared for what Meghan brought to the table. And that was very clear because they were idiots. Your Commonwealth is made up of 2.5 billion people, black and brown people at that. And the one thing that you couldn't do was make sure that one person, the one person who was actually a part of the monarchy, was protected. Because you knew that you could throw her under the bus and it would be so easy to do it. So you fed her to the wolves. Every chance you got, you put a story out there. Because heaven forbid if anybody knows that you're cheating on your wives. Or that you're having babies with other bitches. Or that you do coke. I mean, heaven forbid if they should find out that you're doing any of these things. We got to tell everybody that Meghan Markle hates her father. We have to do that. That makes a lot of sense. They did their tour. They got back to Canada. Harry says that their home was swarmed with paparazzi. Swarmed. Paparazzi in a lake, paparazzi trying to jump the fence, paparazzi around her home. There was paparazzi in their yard. They couldn't escape it. And then COVID hit. And they knew they were closing the borders. Prior to this, Harry got a call telling him that his security detail would be pulled on March 31st. He would no longer have security from the royal family and that he would have to provide his own security. Protection. Complexion of protection. And that's where they left it. Harry and Meghan knew that they had to get out of the country in terms of getting out of Canada in order to be able to protect themselves and, of course, their son Archie. And so they fled. Dude. So they got out. Tyler Perry is the one who helped them get out. So I knew that Tyler Perry was the one who helped them get out after their interview with Oprah. I found that out, but I saw it in the media before that. And I was like, Tyler Perry reached out to help her. That's cool. And that's where I left it. I didn't really dig any deeper. So what they're saying in the documentary is that Tyler had reached out to her and sent her a letter because he had saw what was going on with her father. He saw what happened with her father, how her father basically, you know, took the money and ran with it. He saw all of that. And he decided that he was compelled to reach out to her because he empathized with her and her pain in terms of losing her dad the way that she did, the situation with the media, her sister being just an ungrateful, spiteful bitch, just all types of things that she was going through. He recognized it, he empathized with it, and he wanted to let her know that she wasn't alone and that if she needed anything, that she just needed to call him. He gave her his phone number, he sent it to her in a letter. She ended up going back to Canada after they had abdicated their titles to the queen, and basically she called him and she just broke down into tears. Tyler let her have her moment, and he just asked her what was she afraid of, and she told him, and he told her that her fears were valid. To which that wasn't very comforting, but it was a truth, a hard truth that Meghan needed to hear. And he basically was just like, I had no idea of the royal family. My only idea of the royal family was when Princess Diana, and basically we saw, you could watch how she was walking through, I think it was an airport or something, and she had a tennis racket up to her face. She didn't want to be photographed. They were relentless about trying to get a photograph of her without the tennis racket. She didn't want to do that. She was telling them to get out of her way, leave her alone. They go in the elevator. They try to get in the elevator. They push the dudes out. The other dude squeezes his way in, and they push him out as well. It was so invasive and so weird. It's such weird behavior. She no longer is a part of the monarchy. She's no longer a part of she's no longer a part of it. So why are you trying to get pictures of her and get all in her business? And why are you doing this? Like, it just doesn't make any sense. You no longer have that access to her or anybody who is not in the monarchy. You shouldn't have that type of access to them in the monarchy either. It is beyond the access that you're paying for. You're being invasive and disrespectful. Diana didn't even get the chance to live out her years like she wanted to. She ended up dying in that car accident. And I know that Harry had the same fear that it would happen to his wife, because the same invasive, but it was 10 times worse, was Meghan because of the racial aspect. But the same invasive, disrespectful behavior was happening. And it was happening because they were emboldening it to happen. The institution were reveling in it. They were pushing it forward. I feel so bad for that woman. I feel so bad for her. Tyler Perry got wind of what was happening. Meghan called him and he said, well, I'm going to get you out of there. And she's like, listen, we only need to stay a week until we find a place to stay. We're not trying to, you know, live off of you forever. And he said, don't worry about it. You come and you stay as long as you need to. I'll have everything you need. You have security. You will be protected. No one will bother you. No one will know anything. You'll come and you'll stay at my house and everything will be fine. So they left Canada with Archie, their two dogs, her mom. They all left, came down, and they all went to Tyler's house, and they stayed there for quite some time. And they seemed to be quite happy. And they got to the front of the house, and Harry goes, we go to the front of the house, and it was really nice. And he was like, oh, yeah, this will do. And then they see that the house is bigger than what they thought. And he says, what tripped me out was, Tyler goes, I had you standing in the room with this round bread bed and stripper poles. I said, wait a minute. Back the fuck up. What? Stripper poles? Sir, you supposed to be a man of God, sir. You're supposed to be out here partaking in the depths. You're supposed to be worshiping. You ain't supposed to be in there looking at no secular ass cheeks clapping on no damn pole. Nigga. There's so much going on for right now. Just going into the last parts of this episode. Meghan was pregnant. They moved into their new house in California. She was showing her friends the house and she collapsed. She ended up losing her second child. It was very difficult for her and for Harry. Harry blamed the Daily Mail for their malicious attacks on her, the stress they caused her, that he immediately targeted targeted the Daily Mail for this, and I don't blame him. Prior to all of this, they were explaining what was going on with the litigation and how the Daily Mail used the People magazine press op-ed that they put out, her friends put out, to say that the letter was public knowledge and that she can't say that it was private because her own friends posted about the letter in this People magazine article. So there was that. She ended up losing a child, and then she published a letter in the New York Times about her time being pregnant and losing her baby, and how it was a time for, not necessarily for us to cower and hide when these things happen, but we should talk about it. It should be more open. It shouldn't be shameful. And she's right about that. I felt bad for her. I really did. I still feel bad for Meghan, because I feel like no matter what she does, no matter how many times they put out this documentary, like, they're not gonna believe her. But I believe her. I believe her. She's been consistent this entire time. There's nothing that has changed about that woman and how she operates. If she was lying, you would see a direct contradiction of how she is versus how she was seen versus what she said. But everything that she has said and done has aligned with the person that she's shown herself to be. They also talked about them living in the house with Tyler Perry's house, how that situation got compromised 6 weeks after they got there. It was just a mess. They ended up going back home. Harry ended up going back home specifically because his grandfather passed away. And he was there. He did speak to his brother and his father, but they never apologized for anything that happened. And Harry has resolved himself that he's never going to get that apology. And he and his wife were moving forward from there, which I don't blame them. At this point, an apology is not necessary, but an acknowledgement that things were not what you thought they were would be great. Some accountability would be awesome. And he just said, I know I'm not going to get any of that, so we're just going to move on. They didn't really resolve anything because nobody took accountability for anything. And basically, they just was like, this is just the way that it is, you know. And that was it. And their daughter was born shortly after that. So essentially what was going on here was that I'm at a different part of the show. This is the last episode that I'm on. And basically what happened was Meghan sued the Daily Mail, and they have been chronicling this lawsuit for quite some time. It had been going on for several years, and I believe this is in 2021. Meghan, the judge awarded Meghan the lawsuit. She won, but the Mail appealed. And they continued to appeal, and it got so bad to the point where they had one of the media representatives from the UK come over and say, hey, listen, this letter was not private. She definitely sent it to us for us to clear. We knew about the letter. This person knew about the letter. Everybody knew about the letter. So it wasn't a private letter. And Meghan was just like, no, this is bullshit. Like, she didn't say that, but I'm saying that. This is bullshit. They appealed, and the appeal was denied. Meghan and Harry won their case, and I'm so glad that they won, because this shit is fucking nuts. And this is how you know it's fucked up. Number one, the Daily Mail printed the letter, but they redacted majority of it. Majority of the letter is redacted. It had those black marks on there. So if it was a open letter that you could send without no issues, why did you redact some of the letter? That's the first thing. Secondly, this White House this royal aide that came out was not their aide. That was a part of their media's comm. They were, that aide that came forward was a part of William's media comm. So you can see how they're trying to kill the story and make Meghan out to be the fucking, the monster in this story. You can see how they're trying to structure it. So Meghan is the one who's trying to manipulate the media and lie. And they've been putting out these stories about her for quite some time. This is some bullshit. This is not right. William bald-headed, buck-tooth ass need to have his ass whooped. And his ugly ass foot in the face daddy need to have his ass whooped too. That is your brother and that's your son. At the end of the day, he brought in a woman, number one, who could have helped unify the Commonwealth and bring them apart. But now everything is in shambles. The queen is losing her affinity or her likability in the public. Now, she is dead. God rest her soul. But that the monarch has been losing their likability ever since Meghan Markle and Harry have left. And of course, a lot of the Commonwealth are trying to escape the queen. Jamaica has removed the queen as the head of their government. So did, there's another company that, I mean, another, not company, but another country that did. But they had a whole, they had a very visceral response to the royal family coming and making visits to their country. Jamaica refused, a couple of other Caribbean countries refused, and it's just become a massive uproar arising against the queen and their influence and rejecting being a part of the Commonwealth. They're trying to exit that, and that this catalyst could have been calmed and could have been unified had they had embraced Meghan more and understood what she could have represented for the monarchy and for the people. They chose to discredit her and treat her like she was just trash. Therefore, that direct visceral response to her is now being reflected on the royal family. If you notice when you watch the show, a lot of the people that are a part of the monarch in terms of the Commonwealth, the normal everyday people, they don't hate Meghan. They don't call her names. They're not saying anything rude or disrespectful to her in public. She's able to speak to them. They enjoy her being there. They show her respect. It's the people behind the scenes who are running the show that are mad about this black woman being a part of the monarchy. It's them. It is them. And you know what? I'm glad that they got out. I'm glad that they got out. I'm glad that they are able to be here in the States. And I'm glad that they're able to raise their children in some peace. Because this is just fucking ridiculous. Now, when they got to Tyler Perry's house and they was living in his house, the means of safety that was breached by the time they got there, by the time they figured out they was there, is fucking gnarly. They were in this house chilling, no issues. And then all of a sudden, helicopters are circling. Drones are circling. Do you understand the amount of time and effort you have to put in to sanction fucking drones and a goddamn helicopter to roam over a house 24 hours out of the day? Do you know how much money you gotta pay for gas on a damn helicopter? Just for how much is a fucking picture of Meghan Markle and Harry worth? Because that shit is ridiculous. What are you trying to get exactly? What are you trying to show? That they're living in a house, eating ice cream with their kids, enjoying time with her mom? What are you showing? Child, I'm just floored at the audacity of it. They left the comment. They left the damn UK because they didn't want to have to deal with this. You no longer pay to have access to them. So why are you still invading their privacy? Damn. And there you have it. It ends with a beautiful letter or speech that Meghan wrote to Harry on their wedding. And it was at the reception that she read it. And it capsulized, basically, it encapsulated their entire relationship. And it foretold a lot that was going on, that they were ultimately going to have a family and they were going to be together and it was going to be easy and that love wins, ultimately. And at the end, all you see is Harry walking barefoot, which is something that he enjoys to do. along with Meghan, and they're on their private beach enjoying the sun and the water and just being happy. There's a couple of inserts at the end of the documentary that basically chronicles representative sending over the text from when Meghan sent that letter to her father. This was to help corroborate the Associated Press's story, with them saying that Meghan's letter wasn't private. The attorney, he basically said that he was asked to submit a witness statement by the Duchess of Sussex and by the Associated News. And Meghan's attorney vehemently denied that and said that the evidence that was presented was not presented on her behalf. It was evidence that was used directly by the Associated News' litigation team to further the narrative that her letter was public for everyone. This documentary opened a lot of eyes, but it pissed me off in more ways than one. But I'll say this and be done with it because I've talked enough for the day. The reality of the situation is Meghan was never going to be prepared for what this is. This is, you're a fish in a fishbowl, essentially. You get fed when you need to. You're pulled out and put on display for everybody to see. You're literally inside an aquarium. And for Meghan, being as vocal as she is and as outspoken as she is, that presented a problem for the monarchy because of how popular she became, how vibrant her personality is, how bright her star was, and they needed to dim that. They needed to dim it because she was taken over and they didn't like it. But they could have used that and bolstered that for the monarchy and for the people, so the people could understand that everybody in this world has an opportunity to have a bright light shining somewhere. And they chose to try to break her down as much as possible and turn her into another Kate Middleton robot. And she's not like that. I'm happy that Harry stood up for her. He protected her and his children. And I know that it had a lot to do with what happened with his mom. I mean, shout out to Tyler Perry for coming and helping them and giving them a place to stay and letting them have a month and a half of some peace after living in hell in Canada for months on end and damn near losing their livelihood and just having everything stripped from them so that they were forced to go back to the monarchy. I'm glad somebody offered them some help. Tyler Perry was ultimately named the godfather to their daughter, Lilibet, which I thought was a very sweet gesture and very nice of them to do. He has a son of his own. Tyler Perry has a son of his own. So I know he understands, you know, the type of mama bear, father bear type of protection they have over their children. With all that being said, I hope Meghan and Harry continue to flourish in the United States. I hope that they continue to do their charity work. If Meghan, I bought the cookbook that they was talking about earlier in the show. I went and bought it. It was fairly inexpensive on Amazon. I highly recommend you guys go and buy it. Not for her, but more specifically for the people in the UK who were affected by the Grenwell fire. You could be helping them by purchasing that book. I'm curious to see what else Meghan has to say, more specifically about what she's going to do now and how things have changed. I'm very curious about that. I hope that she puts out a book and, you know, talks about things that she wants to do and how she wants to move and shake from here on out. I'd be more than willing to listen to it and read it. With all that being said, this documentary just really goes to show you that when money, power, and fame is involved, people's true colors do come out. And if you're not careful, it can end up hurting you in the end. There was no way of protecting herself from this or fixing anything. The reality is, everything that she did there was nothing she could do to save herself from any more pain. It was what it was. And we just hope and pray that Meghan and Harry both are happy. Their children are happy. Her family, their families are happy. And one more thing. I'm very glad that her niece is back in the picture, because I was upset that she had to end up severing that relationship sort of with her niece. And that was one of her closest, most private relationships. And she ended up losing that because of her marriage to Harry. So I was glad that that was able to come back. I hope y'all enjoyed my recounts and my reactions to everything that's going on in this Harry and Meghan documentary. I hope you guys have watched the show for yourself, because I promise you it is well worth the watch, because it is just so fucking messy. Okay. But y'all watch it. Let me know what you think. Please make sure you check out the Spotify questions. I'm going to put a Q&A up there. I'm going to put a question in for you guys to answer and tell me what you think about the show. I'll talk to you guys next time. Remember, Auntie loves you. This documentary was very, very well done. And it was honest and earnest. And it was just them telling their truths. Now, there are a lot of people trying to debunk things in the pod, in this documentary, and change the ideals that have been said by others in the documentary with the concept of race and everything being involved. But I will say this. These racial constructs that were created by colonialism are hard to understand when you are not affected by them directly. So I say to everybody who is not a person of color, who does not have to worry about race as much as your fellow man, I would say you need to have a little bit more sympathy and compassion. And I say that to my fellow people of color, that maybe you need to look at this documentary from a different perspective. I see a lot of people using the word white passing and white presenting as a means of trying to demean Meghan or disrespect her. You can't tell someone how their journey and how their walk through life was supposed to be, or how you see it. You can only listen so you can understand their experience. In Meghan's case, I'm pretty sure she wasn't treated like a black woman because she does not look like a black woman. A typical black woman has melanin, very deep melanin in her skin. It's the first thing you see when you see a typical black woman. Meghan represents two sides of the same coin. One Caucasian, one African American. She fits in both worlds, if you ask me. But because of the way she looks, how she carries herself, the way she walks, talks, sits, stands, most people would consider her to be a white passing American. I just consider her to be Meghan. She is who she is. She understands her culture greatly, and she respects other cultures, and that's the way that it should be. I think that we all need to take a step back, stop being so self-righteous, and really start listening to each other. And whether you believe it or not, not all white people are inherently bad, and everybody is not always out to get us. And the same can be said of African Americans and black people alike. We're not all bad. We're not all out to demonize you for things that have happened in the past. Most of us simply want acknowledgement and change. And I think that's fair, given the events that have happened to Americans as a whole, given the things that have happened in this world as a whole. We have all had to fight together to come out of certain things. So I would imagine when something happens to a certain section of people in your country, that you would fight to make them feel safe, happy, and generally just be good people towards them. With all that being said, this documentary opened a lot of eyes and gave you a different viewpoint of what's going on in this world. Hatred in itself is an epidemic. And while a lot of people don't want to believe it, they don't want to see it, most of us experience it before we hit the age of 30. It's wrong, it's cruel, and it doesn't have to be. So I say, when you see this documentary, watch it with open eyes and an open heart, and don't pass judgment, but just truly listen. Because the negative effects of the media and the way that people were trying to protect themselves and backbiting literally almost broke a person. And I felt very bad for her. And as my mama always says, history has a tendency to repeat itself. And luckily for Harry, he didn't have to watch another woman in his life die for the sake of a picture. With all that being said, I hope you guys enjoyed and listened to my ranting, screaming, crying, loving of the documentary. I hope you guys enjoyed the documentary itself, because it deserves some praise. It was well done. Like I said, it was very sweet and loving at its core. And when you get past all the bullshit that they had to deal with, it really is a beautiful love story for two people who were just simply fighting to exist. And that's very, very sad that they had to do that. I wish them nothing but the best of luck. I wish them nothing but love and happiness. And I hope that their children, Lilibet and Archie, are happy and have no idea what their parents had to go through to be together. With all that being said, I hope you guys enjoyed this, and there will be many more podcasts to come. I'm going to invite some friends to come on here with me, and I'm going to post a little bit more of a messier content later. So you're going to have this, and we're going to have the SBC chat, which is coming next. That is very, very messy. And I will explain all of that in the next podcast. With all that being said, thank you so much for listening. And I will see you guys next time.